Thank you again for being with us this evening, and you're of course all invited to our reception after the program, just across the way here, where there is Julia stayed up extra long and made chocolate cake this time to mark our 15th anniversary, so please join us. I was asked to say a couple of things about the construction of the next piece because of its unusual complexity, so if you'll bear with me for a second, we will do that. Schoenberg was really a revolutionary. He took the system of tonality that had been a constant toward the end of the 19th century and in the early 20th century, started to devise new pathways for tonal music. So here are a couple of listening references in this piece that might help, because it's A, quite complex, and B, has a lot of overlapping themes throughout. It was so complex at its time that Schoenberg sold tickets for 10 nights of rehearsals so that the dedicated fans would come and have at least a chance to understand the work. So that's a statement of something. So up until the beginning of the 20th century, we dealt primarily with major and minor keys, which divide the octave intentionally unequally to provide a sense of magnetic pull. So if you listen, for example, Françoise has been practicing her C major scale, slowly would sound something like this. So if Françoise plays the first note and the fifth note of the scale, the C and the G, we can hear that that sounds quite stable. But if she plays the C and the seventh note of the scale, the B, that sounds very unstable and has that magnetic pull that needs to resolve someplace. Please put us out of misery. Oh, thank you so much. Now, another possible option that Schoenberg employs in this is to then divide the scale in equal amounts. So the whole tone scale, so seven notes, one step apart, full step apart, would sound like this. Now, this is where it gets particularly interesting in this piece, because Schoenberg uses quartal hexachords. Now, just in case over brunch today you weren't talking about quartal hexachords, let's talk about it. So it's actually not as complicated as it sounds. Quartal just means four, like do, re, mi, fa. Let's play the interval for us, please. And six, and hexachord just means six notes in a scale. Now what Françoise will demonstrate for us next, which appears in this piece a great deal, are six notes in a row, a perfect fourth apart, starting on a G. This might be the most important fundamental building block of this piece, and that shows up in a number of ways. It shows up in that way, in a vertical way, but also shows up as a chord, where all those notes are stacked on top of each other. We play the first two bars, and if you listen to the final chord, you'll hear all six of those notes being played simultaneously. So here's the beginning. So that's another way that he uses it. Now, sometimes it's used thematically, sometimes it's used as a signaling device, but it retains its importance throughout. Now, one of the things that's interesting, if you remember when Françoise played those six notes from the G up, the last note ends up then being an A flat, which is a semitone away from the original note, which in the terms of circle of fifths is about as far away as you could get. It really doesn't seem like it's connected in any way whatsoever. Here's one other thing to notice. We're in a piece that's ostensibly in the key of E major, yet this is what happens right at the very beginning of the piece. This is bar four, where we'll sustain an F major chord. Enjoy that rare moment of calm and stability, because there aren't many of those to be found through the rest of this piece. So, you know, here we are in a piece that's ostensibly an E major, but here we're starting with an F major chord. Those are a few of the ingredients that make up the construction of this piece, and I hope it will make it easier to understand some of the density of what he's put into this. Now, just also, by the way, of interest, this piece was not launched into obscurity. Schoenberg was very famous, very well established during his day. When it had its premiere 118 years ago, it was performed performed by members of the leading string quartet of the time in Vienna, the Rosé Quartet. The remaining players were the principal players of the Vienna Philharmonic for the original piece, and that was and performed in the Musikverein of all places, where the Vienna Philharmonic still performs today. It was originally written for 15 virtuoso players, so that means this is like 5 to the 3rd power to get this kind of virtuosity to perform this version that his colleague Anton Webern arranged. Schoenberg himself did a full orchestra version of this piece sometimes later, so it has many versions that those versions that people have come to enjoy it. So I'm sure you'll be amazed by the virtuosity of our players, and I hope that allows a little bit of an insight to Schoenberg's monumental chamber symphony. Thank you very much for being here this evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.